What can one expect in the early days of marriage? Married for over 50 years, Marjorie and Dr. Herman Douse still remember their first years vividly.
Well, first year was kind of a little shaky until we got to understand each other. And then it's been pretty good. I can't remember the bad times. So it must have been mostly good.
One night, as I recall, there was a little misunderstanding or a fuss, whatever it was. To this day, we can't figure out what had caused it. So we usually kneel together, put my arm around her, we pray, and we go to bed. This night, we couldn't because, well, there's a misunderstanding. So she went in the bed, turned her face to the wall and her back to me. And I went in the bed and I turned my back to her and my face out to the front of the bed. And after a little while, she turned around and said, "I can't sleep." And I admitted I can't either. So by that time, I said, "Dear, I'm sorry," whatever it was. And by the time I said that, she was all over me, hugging me, and we made up, and it was very good after that. So I learned that in a fuss or misunderstanding, a little spat, whatever it is, the person who thinks that he or she is more right, it will be easier for that person to say, "I'm sorry."
Had any serious disagreements after our first year together? We learned to understand. I know what not to say. I think he does too.
What qualities about each other has been particularly treasured over the years?
Tell you what I really appreciated, the fact that he learned to cook when he was at home, and I didn't learn to cook until I went to school. So there are things he cooks better than I do, and I think he likes to cook and I don't like to. I do it because I have to, but not because I like to, and if I can push it off on him, I will.
She has been and is a very caring person, not just for me or for her children, but for others, you know, beyond the family. And she would always look out for other people. And even if I get a little uptight a little sometimes with her generosity, you know, she would remind me that, well, the Lord has blessed us with something and we are here to share.
In the area of raising kids, Dr. Douse shared on his grow and go philosophy.
He kept reminding them, "Listen, you're growing children and so on. Mommy and daddy, you know, love each other and going to stay with each other. We know that when your children grow up, you will want to go. So you can know from now, yes, when you grow up, you will go, but we'll be here and we'll stay together. So you'll go out and make life for yourself." So they kind of grew up knowing that. They'd all say, "We know that mommy and daddy love each other." They learned that as they were growing up, that they would grow and go in due course. We were not pushing them out, but we had to cut the navel string at some point.
And we are happy that they're all gone.
Grown and gone.
No children, but the grandchildren come every now and then.
Hear how trusting their children proved beneficial for the Douses.
When they were big enough, they had their own key and they could get in the home before we got home. And again, I guess God helped us with the training so that they didn't do anything out of order while we were not there. I recall that in our home, we didn't have or didn't play listen to certain kind of music, and they knew that. And I remember one day we came in and there was this kind of a jump up thing, and as we walked in, our daughter was the first one to explain, "Daddy, everything was going fine, and just like as you were coming in, this kind of music started." And of course I accepted that and I believed her, and she appreciated the fact that I believed her. Now, whether she was tricking us or not, but I made her know that I believe what she said. And that also was helpful to kids. We told them earlier that, look, whatever it is, anything at all that happens, you tell us first and tell us the truth. That's what we want. Anybody else who comes and tells us anything else, we can put that aside, because what you have told us is what we believe. And they grew up to that, to know we had that confidence in them. and they have tried to live up to that a long time.
And we're not saying that our kids were perfect.
No.
They got spanked, and they knew when they did wrong, they knew that we didn't approve of it and so on. They were not perfect kids.
Not at all.
I remember...
It's not their parents were not perfect either.
I remember our first daughter. There's something about the putty. In the windows. And she'd always dig out the putty. And we could never get her to stop. She got so many spankings for that, but it didn't stop her.
Just two or three.
Well, she got enough. But she just liked to dig out the putty. I can't understand why, but that is...
Soft.
Yeah, she said it just felt nice.
Felt nice. Uh-huh.
And she played with it.
And then...
Then Donnie...
My short-sightedness was not to buy her a roll of...
something that she could play with.
A putty thing that the kids could play with. I didn't just didn't think of that at the time. Just a little upset at her digging out from the window.
Whereas she did that, and then Donnie took his vest to bed with him, and he had his toe. He played with that. Sure enough.
Different.
Fun. You see, you know, how different they are.
Sometimes, in a marriage that's struggling, the couple will stay together only for the children's sake. What do the Dowses have to say about that approach?
I don't think that's a good idea.
Stay together.
Personally,
you stay together.
For the benefit of the children. And when the children come of age, you know, and especially when the children leave, they also leave each other. And that's not good. In other words, as the children were growing, the parents, particularly father, because mothers are always more attended to the child, but father to his job maybe, but he had to remember that the children will always be there for a while, but they're going to leave when they grow up. So the parents have to remember that they, if they plan to stick together, not just for the children but for their own sakes. So even when the children go, they need to be together, and they plan to stay together. So even when the children are gone, after all, that's how they started, just the two of them. So the kids come in between and they leave, but the two of them are still there and they need to go on together.
And we don't miss them. We don't miss them. We're glad they're gone. We see them when we see them, and that's fine. But there's no feeling that they belong.
They needed to be here.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, well.
And we feel great when they're gone.
Well, because we try to give them, we try to give them a good jump off in life, so we are not worried about them.
The Dowses explained how the positive influence of their parents' marriages helped them build a strong union.
You know, he was such a good father, took care of his family, he took us out, he took me places, he took me when I wanted to go in gathering, or as a colporteur to sell my books, he took me to his friends and so forth. So he was a good father. He would, as soon as he got his money, his pay, you'd go to the post office and mail off his pay to my mother. She could count on it and collect it because she had to pay her rent. We rented houses. She had to pay her rent and, of course, provide food for the family. But you could always count on it that he would send his money even when he wasn't around. So that sense of responsibility, you know, left a good taste in my mouth, but my sense of responsibility as well. And so my mother and father, they got along just fine. And I wouldn't say they have never fussed or quarreled, but not in our hearing. Maybe when we're gone to bed at night, they would settle their misunderstanding, but I have never heard them quarrel. Neither have my siblings. So to us, that was a good example for me to follow.
And same here, I've never heard my parents fuss. And my mother always looked out for my dad. She knew exactly what he liked and what he didn't like. And she made sure that she took care of him. So I think that is the blessing for both of us, that we had parents who loved each other and respected each other.
Mm-hmm.
And it helped us. And we wonder sometimes why people have difficulty. But then if you come from a different background where your parents are always fussing. It's more difficult to adjust.
What hope is there for persons who come from homes that were less ideal than the ones the Dowsies grew up in?
I was thinking of an example of a poor background for a youngster. But he said later on, he said, the way I saw my act or react each to the other, I determined that would never happen to me. So I am to make a success of my family and never to have that poor interaction with each other. So it can be a motivating factor as well as a
deterrent.
A deterrent to their doing that. But if one has to counsel with such or give them some advice earlier, is to tell them, to remind them that, hey, look, people are different and we react to different situations, etc. So it all depends on what you want to make of it. If you are determined that it will work and you work towards that and both people work towards that, it's going to work you both. So even if you thought that you may have made a mistake, but if you plan to work at it, God is going to bring it through for you. Both people need to work at that. So a little counsel, a little advice, telling them to remember that the Lord, if the Lord brought them together, will see them through, providing they are prepared to work with the Lord in that.
People are different, and you have to learn difference so that you can live with it.
After the break, the Dowsies tell us their secrets to a successful marriage and how they've handled finances, physical changes, and other challenges.